ready?
Oh,
just about.
I'll be right back.
Do you fly?
Nope. Well, guys, it's the last call of the year, so we're happy to have the president, Sam, is talking about how to run mathematics in some eloquent way, with little elements, little contents in it. Before we start, I would like to thank Antoine, right, he's watching me over there. Thanks for your service assembling the slide. Then I would like to thank Sam, who is also in his fifth year, just like Markiplier. So let's welcome Sam to talk about the verbosity.
Thanks, everyone. I'd also like to thank the seminar organizers for inviting me to speak tonight. It's a great honor. This lecture is the culmination of 5 years of work by myself and my colleagues here at Carnegie Mellon in Markov talk theory and the burgeoned field of Markov talk theory. My aim here is to be more or less self-contained. I know there are some experts in the audience. This isn't your first Markov talk. And I apologize in advance if I'm a little bit boring you today. But I want everyone to be able to enjoy this talk, especially the newcomers. And throughout the talk, I expect some of you will feel a little bit confused, especially if you come here. But I hope by the end we're all very confused. All right. So today, right, oral verbosity. Verbosity meaning using a lot of words where very few would do. And this is a critical part of Markov talk theory. That there's very, very little being said, of course, but very many math terms employed. And our goal here is to elucidate some of that theory. So, right, algorithms, the kind of bounds we have, usually related to, they're oral bounds, right? Markov talks are talks. We're speaking, and naturally, when you have an algorithm, you want to see how much can we get out of it, how much juice. Normally, you know, we want high upper bounds for Markov talks. We want lots of words being said, very few ideas. Right, the French mathematicians, we have especially here at Carnegie Mellon, the French mathematicians are very key in the Markov talk literature, the Bukakiists. The Bukaki group, well known for very rigorous and tight upper bounds on a particular Markov talk. Nicholas being one of the founding members of the Bukaki movement, and Lexington Grothendieck. smooth Lexington Grothendieck. He's kind of number two. Right. loads of papers in the early 90s. This was the burgeoning time for the Markov talk. Of course, formally Markov talk started 5 years ago. But a lot of the ideas, right, were coming to develop in the early 90s. Bukaki, Nicholas being at the head of the research here. And they just loaded on the papers. I could spin. Right. Will a drunk man ever get home? Classic in the probabilistic theory. Answered by Grothendieck and Bukaki. And a drunk bird answered as well. Okay. So this is going to fast. The natural question that follows from Bukaki's paper, it was open at the time, was about coke addicts in LA on their way to Tuscaloosa. Bukkake was adamant in trying to attack this question, but it was very, very challenging. Gaping wide open, probably. Yes, Bukkake, I believe he did his graduate work at Berkeley. Spent most of his nights traveling around, as he wants. And being attending bars, he would end up in different places. And this gave him this kind of idea of his own, this question. Take you, right? It's taking space across this other variable y to space. And guess this is time. Y should be time here. Right, so this is the drunk person after an hour. Right. Y represents, the alcohol. Right, sorry. This is an alcohol parameter. Right, so any bound. There's no upper bound here on the alcohol that you'll copy if you consume. Right, home is the whole unit ball here, so we're starting somewhere away from home, as the drunkard walk is a standard. And we're looking at xt, which is random. And we're looking to see when is he going to end up in the ball. Now, everyone knows the standard result for a usual random walk. With a fixed alcohol content, is there's a non-zero probability of returning, right? But there's a possibility of not return. But here the problem is extended with this alcohol parameter to introduce more and more drunkenness. Yes.
What if we plug in negative y?
Negative y. Well, it's highly non-physical to have negative alcohol. I mean, like, we all should have alcohol on us most of the time. So alcohol equal to zero is a very rare case. Almost surely you're always going to have some alcohol. As a grad student, I think, at least. As a grad student, I'm not working on this, so it's natural that Y should only be really considered strictly positive. But at zero, it doesn't cause any problems because it's almost never going to happen. So he was eating his soup and he worked this out. And it's very interesting techniques with Kida-Kinu's forcing central limit theorem. This might be very familiar to some of the experts in the audience. A critical result in Markov talk theory. So all sorts of results follow Bukkake's. Seminal paper on these drunkard's walks with alcohol parameters related to, verbosity theory. And from M. Garcia at MIT, expanded, this one not being in, how do I go back?
Sam, you might have an easier time if you just use
arrow keys
as opposed to the mouse.
Right. Mexican Institute of Tacos. it's a very interdisciplinary university. Tacos and mathematics. Long story history, of course. And drunkard's walk can be very unstable in the level of alcohol. There are fixed levels of alcohol, critical levels of alcohol, where the drunkard walk turns from very decent probability of returning home to have almost virtually zero probability of being home and likely being under a bridge or somewhere in an alleyway with a dog pissing on you. And type of alcohol is also very relevant, which wasn't included in Bukkake's original model. But it's an easy extension that if you substitute sake with tequila, on large timescales, you get a sort of branching process, a Galvanic process, where the alcohol just starts exponentially exploding, right? Because sake, everyone knows that is induces more sake as you do bombs, more bombs will occur. Whereas tequila makes you just throw up and want to stop drinking. This is for tequila. Sorry. I was speaking from my experience. Bukkake had a different, drinking preference than myself. But when the explosion happens, they call this tequila sunrise. And it's related to the Mexican wave equation. If you were coming to our Meanfield Games Theory group, you would know more about this. But we have some experts in the audience, so I don't want to bore them. The Mexican wave equation for Garcia was just the wave equation. Yeah.
Wait, so the reproduction process occurs regardless of whether you get home or not?
You don't need to be at home to be drinking tequila.
Oh.
Very commonly, you're not going to be drinking at home. But, I mean, Bukkake was drinking at home and that when he was at a bar. Yeah.
At what level does the alcohol parameter need to be set for the reproduction process to be memorable?
To be memoryless. If you really want to forget history, you really need at least. I think you know it's a very non-trivial, but like 13 pi over 74 is really considered like the critical value where the memoryless property gets cut in. But it really depends on you know your level of you know drinking experience. Bukkake is very. It's a parameter, really, that's depends on the person. It starts at 17 pi over 74. That is the standard first time drinking parameter for memoryless property. Good questions. Very good questions. Yeah. You.
Is day drinking taken into account in this model?
That's a very good question. Day drinking is very common in tequila-based models. Sake, not so much. So I would say that in the seminal work by Garcia, there was probably day drinking involved. But I haven't read this paper carefully, so I really can't speak for it. Anything else?
What parameter does driving the Brownian motion pass over the? Become a legal mathematical operation.
Right. When does it stop being legal? So there's an upper bound threshold for where it stops being legal.
Isn't it just a matter of some boundary values?
It's the kind of thing where it's well known that there exists some upper bound. Where it's like, you can't reasonably drive. You're never going to get home, and you're probably going to cause a problem if you're driving above that limit. But the standard theorems that state this are compactness theorems, so there's no real clear level where that barrier is. The legal limit, right, I think it's something like 0.08, but it's not really like hard set where that is going to be the true value. It's just kind of arbitrary. And, you know, it's like p-values. It's kind of just someone said that it's this value, because they need to set a value. The true value where driving stops being effective, right? There's just some existence there. All right. The choice principle should not be taken for granted. And it's a special version of choice that comes into the theory here called sexy choice. Sexy choice, I think, is this is not something that's implied by choice. Sexy choice is, has a lot in common with choice. A lot of the same results hold, but. Here we're looking at six objects in particular, and this is pretty reasonable. I mean, no one has any qualms with with, you know, choosing from six. So if you have a problem with standard choice, sexy choice, this is pretty good for everyone. And sex means, it's six in Latin. This is how it got its name. This is six choice. And all sorts of reproduction occurs in branching models as a consequence of sexy choice. Right, six seems funny though. I mean, one always seems important. I mean, I always say that in analysis, there's, what numbers are there? 0, 1, finite, you know, infinite. That's basically the only numbers I deal with, last six. Right, but there's a real combinatorial reason for why this is. I mean, sex, you know, is a very discrete operation, so it's pretty normal that the combinatorics is going to be relevant for sex choice. If you have six objects, three objects are either pairwise reproductively active or pairwise indifferent. This is, you know, just like a Ramsey theorem type argument. But DT, well-known set theorist, the real DT, as he prefers, right, he was discovered by DT, and he's always talking about, you know, fake math, this DT. He's a kind of like a fringe mathematician, but we thank him for his sexy choice theorems.
Speaking of the internet, I mean, you've been talking about like a discrete model of sex, but I've seen some really indiscreet models of sex on the internet lately, and I was wondering if you've got any experience with those.
Personally, I've only had sex with a discrete number of objects. But I have heard of those who... Oh, so I think this is a different definition of sex, perhaps, that we're setting up. Is that the issue?
It's not discrete.
I mean, perhaps sex may be a spectrum, but having sex always seemed discrete to me. I haven't read these theorems. Perhaps we can talk about it after the talk. So, following the work of DT, there was a combinatorist who was remodeling his house, and I got him thinking, if my contractor keeps destroying the bathroom with his bowel movements every 4 days, how do you avoid this? Now, it may be strange that this is a model of sex, but I mean, it's pretty natural to go to the bathroom after sex, and although I don't know if this guy was doing it with a contractor, it's just the kind of thing where you don't want to, you know, they're in your house, you don't want to tell them that they can't use your bathroom, but they're really sticking up the place and it's causing problems for your wife and kids. But the way you can work this out is by looking at four colored complete graphs on peanut-shaped vertices with smiley faces. I guess this begs for an image. So we have four colors. Alright. I don't even know how to draw a colored graph. It's complete. Here are the peanuts. One of them is Mr. Peanut with a top hat. Here's his cane. And right. The blue peanut, red, green, yellow. And many smiley faces. And fake news are formed by the image vector given by throwing a fair coin at each vertex, avoiding others. Right, so something about, the idea here is that if we throw a fair coin, and for each one of these smiley faces, and then we try to avoid landing the coin on the graph. I mean, I drew this graph vertically, so it's extremely easy to avoid. But if I was to put the graph down on a table and flip the coin at the center, then by avoiding the peanuts, well, okay, so we didn't really explain this fake news map, but by applying fake news, 314 comes out. This is a poorly explained theorem. The experts know what I mean here. Someone cares to chime in.
I'll take the help.
yeah. 314. Oh, this must mean something. I don't know. Okay. P.F. Chang's is a pretty natural thing to have after you get a DUI. P.F. Chang's is also a natural thing to have before you get a DUI. Right. So this is kind of a sad story. After P.F. Chang's was used to destroy the combinatorious bathroom, because of course the alcohol in the P.F. Chang's, there was okay. Right, go over. I said the slide. Right, so this guy took all the publications, and you know, he was very mad at P.F. Chang, so apparently he's a local mathematician. Perhaps one of the professors we have a combinatorious pass here. All right. After we were talking about what theorem is. This is the 314 theorem. The 314 fake news theorem. We want to, if we want to prove this, right, clean proof. By clean we mean completely crazy. Well, we want it to be verbose, certainly, but the mayhem could be a problem. We want it to be seemingly all there, but lots of words and lots of confusion. It's pretty hard to identify what that means, but this is kind of one of the central points of verbosity in mathematics. Someone has to, you have to be convinced that this is mathematics, but you also need to have a lot of words to be very, very confusing. So here's the definition of mayhem. We have two words, A and B, as multi-sets of letters. Seeing the order might not matter, but order usually matters in words. So this may be a little intuitive, but we look at the discommon words, or discommon letters, and the mayhem of the proof, right, is the average mayhem of a pair of consecutive words. So, if the words were all the same, there would be no mayhem. But if you use lots of different words, we introduce lots of mayhem. So here's a proof of mayhem 3. Nice. This is one of my favorite proofs of love mayhem. K times n choose k equals n times n minus 1 choose k minus 1. Selector selects list t, selects secret. Selector selects secret list t. Selects rest. I think this needs to be broke down. We should be breaking this down. So the selector selects from the list T's and he puts one aside. That's the secret one. Selector selects secret list T and then selects rest. Right, so I mean, here, of course, this is, you choose one guy out of the end, right? There's other ways to do this, and you choose, you know, the other rest of the K, and then, here we're just choosing K out of. Since I was an undergrad. Right, this is one way of choosing k, but then we have k more. And this way is the way of choosing k minus 1, where we choose 1, and then we choose from the k minus 1. Here we choose k. Obviously not the same. All right, so I obviously am stumbling over these combinatorial proofs, not good at the board, but this was a very nice slide. I really like this slide. But how can we optimize these proofs, right? I mean, this is a pretty optimized proof. This is extremely low mayhem. One of the most mayhem proofs for a sensible theorem I've ever seen. Right. And the approach here is to use a random selection to help optimize here, using the abracadabra. Abracadabra. And this monkey is by, theorem is by Monkey DL. Right, he was around in the Great Pirate Era, part of the Pirate School. A monkey will minimize the mayhem of any theorem P almost surely. Now this is extremely, extremely unintuitive because monkeys are very poor at typing sentences like selector selects this thing, selector selects. Unless your keyboard only has SEs and Ls, maybe Ts. But this is true when they type keystrokes independently. Right, grad students do not behave like monkeys. Grad students don't have independent keystrokes. Their advisors are heavily influencing their keystrokes. So, like, almost surely, if you take a grad student, they're going to heavily be influenced by their advisor. Yeah.
Yeah, what about the undergraduate students?
Undergraduate students have, the problem is they have lack of good ideas. They may be independent, but they're never going to be able to reduce mayhem because they can't optimize at all. So it's a troubling, but it's a true consequence. P almost surely. Almost surely.
Wait, I'm sorry, can you remind, what's the difference between a monkey and an undergrad?
Right, they're very similar objects. But, it really comes down to the fact that monkeys have much more independence than the undergrads. That's what it really is. I mean, as you see here, monkeys, right, monkeys can make independent keystrokes. Undergrads are heavily influenced, but it kind of is like it's like a pseudo-independence. They seem to be independent because they come up with their own ideas, but the ideas are all bad. So it seems like independence, but really it's just nothing though. Okay. Any questions? I might be going a little fast, sorry. I said I wanted this to be self-contained.
One question.
Yes.
So what will happen to the monkey at the wine tasting night?
The wine tasting night. You're saying will it change the independence of the keystroke? Or will
yes.
it increase or decrease mayhem?
Maybe like for the application of like mayhem minimizing.
Well, okay, this leads kind of to right. We weren't really going to be talking about this leads to the theory of you know, by Bukaki of the drunkard monkeys, but we don't really want to talk about that because this kind of introducing like bringing these two theories together kind of makes a lot of technical there's a lot of technical issues that. We're trying to keep it simple here. As I said, I want this to be self-contained. So, drunkard monkeys are not something we'll be considering. Okay. Right, so we don't want to use grad students. But if you, I mean, they don't have independence, but you get a much faster convergence. I mean, grad students are usually better at getting things out than monkeys, but the grad students don't have independence. Right, I mean, we have sufficiently regular kernels, and they're, right, they're much more efficient with the keystrokes. They're just not going to give you the correct kind of mayhem that you're looking for.
Alright, something to machine learning, something.
Alright, so, right, here we're going to work out this an estimate. I want to do this kind of in a little bit of detail because this is pretty important. For an upper bound for mayhem of minimizers, you form uniformly over all theorems. Right? And this is the Chinese, okay, it's, I guess it's by Chinese, Japanese, Korea. Okay. The mayhem of a mayhem minimizing proof of any theorem is uniformly bounded by 2. So the most, least mayhem you get any proof is 2. Right over here. Alright, so here's a proof. Suppose that every word an in a proof has exactly one letter. Now you might say this is an extremely strong assumption. But I tell you, there are a lot of words with one letter. And if you take a lot of one letter words and string them together, then they look like multiple letter words if you reverse the procedure on these words or screening. Right. All right. Right, and of course, if the letters are different, then the mayhem of the two letters is 2. And so, every proof could be done with mayhem at most 2, just by using one letter words. So, right, this is a very short proof, for a nice theorem, very useful theorem. These proofs always exist in the Far East. Yuan Ren Chao had some amazing essays in Chinese, each only one syllable. This is a nice application of the theorem. This is a good example. Okay. It reads like she, sheesh. And the experts in the audience really understand this one. Everyone else, I apologize. Alright, and these are so very, very sharp results were developed by the school in the Far East and using the blow up method. And this is a grad student theorem. Every mayhem minimizing proof has mayhem 0. This is extremely unintuitive. But you take all the words in a proof, make it one word, and just by saying that word. Alright, we'll call this one A naught. Bn is going to be the same word, with the exception of quoting the F word. Right, so, okay, so you take the F word and you leave it out of the original proof, right? And every other letter is the same in this word. And then, here, this is an example of how you do this. We take... Alright, I'll entertain this. Selector selects list T's, select secret, selector select secrets, list T's, selects secret, selects rest. Selector selects list T's, selector secret, selector. As you can see, this is extremely relevant to verbosity, and so on. Probably right. So here's the issue with the proof. The mayhem of the proof, right? If you take 1 over n minus 1, the sum of the disjunction between two words, is only seminor, similar to BV or W1P. But we really want the full power, the full power of the norm here. This can be zero for non-trivial objects. We have proofs, right? These mayhem minimizing proofs, which have zero mayhem, but they're non-trivial proofs. These are really good proofs. Yeah. Very informative proofs. Okay. So really, it's kind of saying that mayhem minimizing is not the kind of semi-normal loop, right? We should be thinking of minimizing the length, or entropy, or some kind of unreadability of a proof to really define what a good mayhem is. All right.
Wait, Sam, can you go back for a second?
Sure.
I can't make out that 49th word in the Chinese Japanese for
it's
she.
It's she.
Oh, thanks.
This one. Is it she or she? Okay. Yeah, I know. Chinese is not my first language. Right. So we've been spending all this time talking about proof optimization with respect to mayhem. Just this past month, this is, you know, gone from almost no one talking about this topic to 14 people talking about this topic. An amazing algorithm was pulled together for reducing the unreadability of proof. As I said, we want readability, we just want it to sound really fancy. And this can be summarized as follows. You read the proof and rewrite it without changing anything too quick. Don't make any sudden changes in the language. But make it just as self-contained as possible. No nonsense. This is an inductive proof, right? So every single time we go through the proof, we want to reduce unreadability. Suppose for the sake of contradiction that if they correct the changer, soudainement, voilà. I can read French, but I can't understand it. Don't do it. It's also well known since grad students don't really enjoy to, do these kind of computations and flip around textbooks. Equation 2.EQ.4 One should try to avoid this. If you want to make nice proofs, stop telling people to run around all over the book. And the last thing you got to do, right, is prove necessity by taking all the nonsense and you sum it up over the cube, and then you just keep applying it to the beginning. So, right, that's just switching the integrals. So you do this inductively until you reduce all the nonsense.
Do we need cubes? It seems like any convex bounded is okay.
The periodicity is kind of important here. You have to have some kind of structure like that, like a periodic structure.
The cube is not.
So what do they call it? Parallel pipelines and stuff.
Okay.
Alright. So let's think about a theorem T and consider all the proofs of T. And we've been interested in the simplest proofs. Simplest to me, but they still have to sound pretty nice, pretty fancy. But ima- measure the kind of readability of groups. So this is the frustration map. The extent at which you want to punch the author with the face. Left as an exercise to the reader, as a soul proof, as itself is infinite frustration. If you put it in a proof, it highly, depending on the length and the complication of the exercise, changes the frustration of this. But one of the things that we were looking for in frustration theory is determine the smallest frustration for all proofs that proof theorem. We want to have the least frustrating proof, of course. Now, of course, this is kind of difficult to compute because frustration, you know, it's different people get frustrated by different things. But Cummings here at Carnegie Mellon has made some good progress. He's very good at coming up with minimally frustrating proofs. And maybe this is not Cummings, this is just Jay Cummings. I shouldn't give Cummings the...
There's no ass.
That's right. probably more related to Bukkake. there exists a universal constant C such that for any theorem,
right,
if some subset of proofs are written by undergraduates, then all, of course, they're going to be more frustrating. So, for some theorems, the frustrating, you know, this constant C is not always going to be tight. Some theorems are always going to have a frustrating proof, and so this doesn't give a tight bound on those. But there exist some theorems which could have a very non-frustrating proof, but not written by an undergrad, right? Not, especially not if it's for the first class of analysis. But reducing frustration by coming is seminal paper where you put all the results. But you know, right, this C is unknown. We just know that you can look at papers and see, you know, like there are numerical bounds. Everyone's see how frustrating proofs are written by undergrads. But it's not unknown what the least frustrating proof ever written by an undergrad was. Okay.
Wait.
Is there a question?
Can you
get back
to the previous slide, please?
Sorry.
Yeah, so is there is known some empirical values for constant C, at least? I mean, so if you go and look in practice, then what?
As I said, there have been lots of numerical results for the frustrating.
Oh,
the problem is a lot of them don't, you know, they don't scale things correctly, right? There needs to be a standard for, like, what frustration is, and there's a lot of personal, ways to measure frustration. So, like, to actually state, in any given scale, there exists some C, right? But the problem is, like, there is no real standard for what the frustration is.
Thank you.
Yeah. Anything else?
Yeah, so what would the so I can get a better sense of this, what would the frustration be of the sexy choice in a bargaining game that is denied?
Right. So...
I think you should read the paper Reducing Frustration by Tommy.
Right, most of it's outlined in the paper, but right, what's the undergrad bound for so with the when it comes to the sexy
is this first name Jack coming?
there's a lot of frustration, like when you're denying a sexy choice, but all right, I gotta be honest. I haven't read the paper carefully. Yeah, as Chris recommended.
So also, this theorem we are proving the lower bound.
Right.
There is not any upper bounds in this frustration.
No. There, undergrads can write unbelievably frustrating.
this is clearly not the case.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you know if we have a copy of this paper in the library, or just like type on Google producing frustration by comment?
you might want to try not sign that first. And then if you don't get any hits, you can go.
Okay.
Any questions? Okay. All right, so let's consider a theorem. And take some positive body. And then we're looking at, right, since we know what happens with undergraduates, we're interested in what's happening after you get the degree. Right? So we'll look at the set of proofs written after the undergraduate degree, all years after the undergraduate degree. So for a fixed theorem, the mapping from how many years after your degree to the frustration, this is the minimum frustration, is continuous. So you are going to be, as you get older, your minimum, the proofs that you can write are going to be continuously changing in frustration. There are no age-old insights. You get 30 and then all of a sudden you're writing. So the frustration of your degree obviously is going to be decreasing up until the point you get tenure. And then there's exponential growth. Right? And this is just because you no longer care the quality of anything you do, any of your work. You don't need to care. Right? This is all on average, right? We're thinking about average frustration. So the point of retirement, most people reach frustration low, at least enough of them to cause a singularity in average. Okay, so we've been seeing these results between how far you are in mathematical maturity, how far you are after the degree, and theorems. And this is going to motivate a few definitions. If we say theorem is sex, if and only if, its proof contains six mutually exclusive cases. Back to six here. Sigma m of t denotes the number of sex produced by mathematician m of t, here t. So, most theorems are not sex. In fact, theorems that are sex remain are usually, that's way too many. But the people have been interested in sex theorems for a long time, and the conservation of time energy principle follows. Remember that, is that an I? I m of t, the number of theorems written by m in year t. I think this is supposed to be six. Oh, okay. No, this is the number of sex produced by a mathematician. And this is the number of theorems. Okay, so we're interested in the, right. So if you take any years, this should be years after your bachelor's. The amount of sex times the amount of theorems should be no more than g over t. What's g? G should be some universal constant. Very large to account for, like, after you graduate, you might produce a lot of theorems, right? You probably won't produce that much things. G is here, right? Oh, this is the concept of reproductivity, right? Obviously you can have more sex if you have more G, more reproductivity. And here's an open question that I want to leave you guys with. If we have any function f, then sex over f, number of sex over f goes to zero. Sex must be decaying really fast. Right. Okay.
sorry.
Yes.
When you have g as a constant here, doesn't that contradict the earlier results by Bukaki where with alcohol reproduction is exponential?
Right. It would seem like it. The thing is, this g can get really large. Right. The thing is, I think usually, on average, alcohol probably is reduced after grad school, and so really this regime where you know the alcohol becomes relevant is for fairly small t. Not that small considering I'm going on year six, but relatively small compared to the number of theorems output because here like theorems for me is less than two. maybe one if you call it a theorem. Alcohol might be high, but theorems are still pretty low, so the bound stays. The bound works out.
Does G depend on M or universal?
Is G universal? This G holds for a certain class of mathematicians. But it's on, okay, so, right, for mathematicians with, right, if you're going to want to apply it for fairly small t, you're going to have to exclude certain mathematicians that write lots of theorems, but that's a very small subset of mathematicians. So for the vast majority of mathematicians, there's a fixed constant g. But it doesn't say here, but there's some technical assumptions along the way. Okay, that's all I had to say. Thank you. Okay, any questions for the big reveal? We all have fun.
A quick question.
Yes.
So Adrian very astutely brought up a question of indiscrete sexy choice.
Right.
And I was curious about the relationship of that, so going into the realm of continuous mathematics. Now, will Brownian motion yield a reproductive process?
Brownian motion of itself is not reproductive.
Not reproductive.
But motion. If you...
if I remember correctly, oceanic motion does.
You can append reproductive behavior onto Brownian motion, and you need, as you said, you need six Brownian motions, right? And then when you have them come together, right, that's when you're going to have sex. But it's very low probability that any of these Brownian motions will have sex more than a couple of times. I don't know if that answered your question.
Brownian motion, reaction on Brownian motion.
this isn't really my, I don't know, this isn't my expertise. Any other questions? Alright, thanks guys. Here, our lovely contributors. If you want, you can scroll back and see.
Let's spend it again.